Hachette Audio presents Chernobyl, the history of a nuclear catastrophe. Written by Serhii Plokhy. Read by Ralph Lister. To the children of the nuclear age. Preface. There are 8 of us on the trip to Chernobyl, marked on my Ukrainian map as Chernobyl. Besides me, there are 3 science and engineering students from Hong Kong who are on a tour of Russia and Eastern Europe. Then, as far as I can tell from their accents, there are 4 Brits, 3 men and 1 woman, all in their 20s. I soon learn that the men are indeed British, while the woman, whose name is Amanda, is proudly Irish. They are getting along quite well. A few weeks earlier, when Amanda asked her British husband, Stuart, what he wanted to do on their forthcoming vacation, he said he wanted to go to Chernobyl. So they came, accompanied by Stuart's brother and a family friend. 2 computer games had provided the inspiration for the trip. In Stalker, Shadow of Chernobyl, a shooter survival horror game, the action takes place in the Chernobyl exclusion zone after a fictional second nuclear explosion. In Call of Duty Modern Warfare, the main action figure, Captain John Price, goes to the abandoned city of Pripyat to hunt down the leader of the Russian ultranationalists. Stuart and his team decided to see the place for themselves. Vita, our animated young Ukrainian guide, first takes us to the 30-kilometer exclusion zone, and then to the more restricted 10-kilometer one. 2 circles, one inside the other, with the former nuclear power plant at their center, and a radius of 30 kilometers, 18.6 miles, and 10 kilometers, 6.2 miles, respectively. We get to see the Soviet radar called Duga, or Arch, a response to Ronald Reagan's Star Wars Strategic Defense Initiative, by today's standards, a low-tech system. It was designed to detect a possible nuclear attack from the east coast of the United States. From there, we proceeded to the city of Chernobyl, its nuclear power station, and the neighboring city of Pripyat, a ghost town that once housed close to 50,000 construction workers and operators of the destroyed plant. Vita gives us radiation counters that beep when levels exceed the established norm. In some areas, including those close to the damaged reactor, they beep non-stop. Vita then takes the decimeters away and shuts them off, just as Soviet workers sent to deal with the consequences of a disaster did back in 1986. They had to do their work, and the decimeters showed unacceptable levels of radiation. Vita has her own job to do. She tells us that in our whole day in the zone, we will get the same amount of radiation as an airplane passenger absorbs in an hour. We trust her assurance that the radiation levels are not too crazy. Altogether, 50 million curies of radiation were released by the Chernobyl explosion, the equivalent of 500 Hiroshima bombs. All that was required for such catastrophic fallout was the escape of less than 5% of the reactor's nuclear fuel. Originally, it had contained more than 250 pounds of enriched uranium, enough to pollute and devastate most of Europe. And if the other 3 reactors of the Chernobyl power plant had been damaged by the explosion of the first, then hardly any living and breathing organisms would have remained on the planet. For weeks after the accident, scientists and engineers did not know whether the explosion of the radioactive Chernobyl volcano would be followed by even deadlier ones. It was not, but the damage done by the first explosion will last for centuries. The half-life of the plutonium-239 that was released by the Chernobyl explosion and carried by winds all the way to Sweden is 24,000 years. Pripyat is sometimes referred to as the modern-day Pompeii. There are clear parallels between the 2 sites, but there are differences as well, if only because the Ukrainian city, its walls, ceilings, and even the occasional window pane, are still basically intact. It was not the heat or magma of a volcano that claimed and stopped life there, but invisible particles of radiation, which drove out the inhabitants but spared most of the vegetation, allowing wild animals to come back and claim the space once built and inhabited by humans. There are numerous marks of the long-gone communist past on the streets of the city. Communist-era slogans are still there. And inside the abandoned movie theatre, a portrait of a communist leader. Vita, our guide, says that no one can now tell who is depicted there. But I recognise a familiar face from my days as a young university professor in Ukraine at the time of the catastrophe. The painting is of Viktor Chebrikov, the head of the KGB from 1982 to 1988. It has miraculously survived the past 30 years, undamaged except for a tiny hole near Chebrikov's nose. Otherwise, the image is perfectly fine. We move on. It is strange, I think to myself, that Vita, an excellent tour guide, cannot identify Chebrikov. She also seems at a loss to explain the sign saying meat, milk, and cheese, hanging from what was once the ceiling of an abandoned Soviet-era supermarket. How come, she asks, they write that in the Soviet Union there were shortages of almost everything? I explain that Pripyat was in many ways a privileged place because of the nuclear power plant, and that the workers were better supplied with agricultural produce and consumer goods than the general population. Besides, the fact that there were signs saying meat or cheese did not mean that those products were actually available. It was the Soviet Union, after all, where the gap between the image projected by government propaganda and reality was bridged only by jokes. I retell one of them. If you want to fill your fridge with food, plug the fridge into the radio outlet. The radio was telling the story of ever-improving living standards. The empty fridge had its own story to tell. It was on my trip to Pripyat that I decided I had to tell the saga of Chernobyl. It would be for the sake of those who were not around at the time, but who wanted to know and understand what had happened on that fateful night of April the 26th, 1986, and in the days, months and years that followed. Despite the Soviet government's initial efforts to conceal the Chernobyl disaster and downplay its consequences, it became well known in the Soviet Union and in the West, and received a great deal of public attention, starting with journalistic reports filed in the first days after the explosion, and ending with documentary films, feature movies, non-fiction investigations, and novels. Although the key to understanding the causes, consequences, and lessons of the disaster is historical contextualization and interpretation, few historians have addressed the subject to date. This book is a work of history. In fact, it is the first comprehensive history of the Chernobyl disaster from the explosion of the nuclear reactor to the closing of the plant in December 2000, and the final stages in the completion of the new shelter over the damaged reactor in May 2018. As I embarked on my research of the history of Chernobyl, I was helped enormously by the recent opening of previously closed archival collections dealing with the disaster. Many government archives opened their doors more widely than before, making it easier to consult documents issued by the Communist Party and government agencies at the time and in the aftermath of the disaster. The Maidan uprising and the Revolution of Dignity of 2014 in Ukraine also produced an archival revolution that allowed unprecedented access to previously closed KGB files. I was writing this book both as a historian and as a contemporary of the events being discussed. At the time of the explosion, I lived in Ukraine, less than 500 kilometers downstream Dnieper of the damaged reactor. My family and I were not directly affected by the ordeal. But a few years later, doctors in Canada, where I was a visiting professor at the time, told me that at some point my thyroid had been inflamed, a worrisome sign of radiation exposure.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.